to go beyond the person once you attain Nirvana. So it's a non-person concept, which is difficult to understand as long as you are in that person. And we get attached to what we call the person, the aggregate of all these different faculties. And the Buddha has very clearly explained about the different, like the solidity, fluidity, then the space, vijnana, that's the consciousness, all these things that come together to form the existence.
So it's a part of the attachment, and is it the yatihita?
Yatihita is where all the roots are.
Yes.
Yatihita is the depth of the pool, as I said. And some people over the ages would have eradicated and made that pool shallow. The waters does not run that deep.
Yeah.
Right? So therefore, when you calm the mind, you can immediately see what the root cause is. But if the pool is very deep, and you have dug a very
great,
big hole,
yeah,
right, big hole and filled it with water, right. So the deeper your hole is dug, I mean, we see people digging holes all the time, right. So you're just observing every day. You see every day. So all you can do as a person who knows Buddhism, and being guided by the Buddha Dhamma, because that is our guide. It is not a religion that you have to practice and have rituals and all these things. The Buddha was against that. Even until the first century, from the Buddhism I know, there had not been an icon. No idol worship had ever been there in Buddhism. So it came through the Greek. The first Buddhist statue was made in the image of Apollo, a Greek god. Right? So that is, this is how things develop into a corruption. But if you go to the Mulastra, the original concept of the Buddhism, then the sutta, the words of the Buddha, like the Dhammapada and the Majjhima Nikaya, you get many volumes of what the Buddha had taught. They give a complete analysis of how it has developed into the present state.
Then we come to Yatihita. Which do you think that we carried forward from each birth to each birth with all this ignorance?
Okay, Yatihita is a program that you, if you take the Uduhita as the person programmer, okay, a computer, we can understand computers now. You see, Deep Blue was invented in 1997 and it beat Kasparov, right, in a chess game. Then artificial intelligence was taken seriously by people, right? So now we know that the external thing that you see in a person is like a computer program. He's programming all the time. But what goes into the software, you don't see.
No.
Software will drive the program. So now it's become user-friendly and you're using all these things. So when you see a person, the person's personality is like what you see in the outcome of the program. Yatihita, or the unconsciousness, not the subconscious, there are so many variations, but real term is unconscious. Unconscious mind is something that you're not aware of. Bringing that into awareness is what setting up of mindfulness does. So as long as you're unconscious, you can't do anything about it. So that is avidya, that is ignorance. You're not even aware that it's there.
Yeah. When does it come up?
It comes up in terms of behavior. So only
radical behavior and all those type of things.
Yeah, a person's behavior, what you call personality, is a behavior trait. And you don't realize that there is a deep-rooted cause for that. It could be in this life.
Or next life.
Or the previous life.
Which has come from the past life.
Past lives. And then the basic concept of believing in reincarnation is an individual choice. There have been many scholars, I would not like to mention some of the people, who are erudite scholars who deny reincarnation. Because they can't personally experience that. So unless you can really mindfully meditate and experience to yourself that you are aware of a previous existence or traits that are coming from it, or the people around you are people who have lived with you over
ages,
innumerable years, right? You can't really put a number on it, right? Like the Buddha has said, it's a cycle, in the samsaric cycle that you have.
You met these people and you meet them again and then
again and again. So we say that the world is such a small place. This is not something that started in Sri Lanka, but Western countries also, because they keep meeting the same people all over. And there are so many billions of people, but yet they are traveling in a very small circle in this life. And all these stories that, you know, people write, they are not, you know, serendipity of, you know, finding something that is unusual. There's no coincidence. There is a design. So they say fate. But we don't say fate. We are not fatalistic people. We say there is a reason, there is a cause, and there's an effect. And effect is not fate, but effect is certainly the outcome.
So you can't have cause without effect, and effect you can't have without cause.
Fate is something that's unseen, somebody else is driving. No, we are driving. We are in this vehicle, we are driving. So until you attain the ultimate stage of nirvana, this will continue.
So how does meditation purify this?
Meditation is the only way you can access the unconscious mind.
Mind.
So it opens the door to the unconscious. Now the scientific theory of psychology invented by Sigmund Freud is to tap the unconscious, first using psychotherapy.
Then he went to hypnotism.
First what happened was he used hypnotism. Mm. Then he abandoned that and went to psychoanalysis, which he thought was more scientific, because hypnotherapy can induce a dreamlike state.
Yes.
And things that you have read and you have identified
can come up in that.
Yeah, so it's a corruption. Then you don't know exactly the root cause or whether this is a concoction of imagination which is active at the time. But psychoanalysis will give you, you know, like you show a picture and ask a person to describe. Different people will describe in different ways because they will interpret it using their root, what is in the unconscious.
Yes.
Okay, then you analyze that person and say, okay, these are the traits that you have inherited because of this root cause. Mm-hmm. So once they understand the root cause, they eradicate the external symptoms, the behavior. So it's actually treating the root, not putting a plaster on the problem. So psychotherapy, in the Buddhist idiom, what the Lord Buddha did was to teach people and treat people. There were people who are ready to learn, and there are people who are ill,
yes,
psychologically, physically, so many ways.
So breathing also helps this.
Breathing is the beginning because
of the meditation.
Yeah, because we have evolved. Hmm. You know, Buddhism has very clearly explained that we have evolved. There's an evolution which made it very popular in the Buddhist, in the Western world, because when Darwin discovered this theory of evolution, that was thought to be anti-Christian.
Mm-hmm. You see? By the church and all that.
But then here is a person who has said, I've been many animals in my previous lives, right? Pansipanas Jatake is about different animals. Mm-hmm. So I've been a fish, I've been a monkey and all that. But in actual fact, genetically we have.
Yes.
Even if you don't believe in reincarnation, our genetics came from, you know, far back.
Shall you have a break?
Yes.
Once again, now the Japanese, who has gone into this meditation scheme, they devolve it into alpha, theta,
brain waves.
Mm-hmm. Why that comes in? They find it easier for them to meditate using
biorhythm. Yeah.
Biorhythm and doing it.
EEG technology.
Yeah, but do they come up to achieve the same status?
Yes, they achieve the equanimity or, you know, the calming of the mind. Mm-hmm. But whether it is sustained over long term or whether they use it for deep penetration, we don't know. Right? It's a stress control for the Japanese, what they understand, because the brain functions on essentially four different levels.
Yes.
Beta is the cycles per second that is at the most active, like between